the other camera started, and we will get started with our morning show. Hello, everyone. I am Jonathan Little. I'm here today with
Mr. James.
Why aren't you at school today?
I'm not school.
You didn't go to school? Yeah. Today is Yom Kippur, I believe.
And I go to my maestro today with Thomas Wake Up.
When Thomas wakes up, you are going to Little Maestros. That is right. You are you planned ahead, didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah? I thought we were going to have an interview. So, listen, James. Have you been enjoying going to school?
No.
Is that a yes or no? Gotta speak up so they can hear you.
I'm just sitting back to the door, yeah. And then I should do that.
Can you speak English, please? What are you doing? Show everybody what you're playing with. Look. This is a bracelet that I won. Where is this from? 2007 Turks and Caicos Poker Classic. I remember that final table. I was there with like number one and number two in the world back in the day. Mike McDonald and, what's the guy's name? His online name was Choppy. Timex and Choppy. They were like, I don't even know if they were 18. they were barely 18 if they were 18. They were so young. Oh, the good old days. Today, we're actually going to talk about preparation. James has already planned ahead, aren't you? You have the day off, so you're going to make use of it by going to Little Maestros, hang out with your brother. Can you please speak English? They're going to think that you're not speaking English anymore. Do you know any new songs?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Awesome, awesome. Can you sing?
You want me to do that?
What is that? It's a bracelet. It's a bracelet. Here, put it on your wrist.
No, I want to like that.
Okay. Shores, new poker coaching member. Congrats. Actually, funny enough, two of my students yesterday messaged me. One of them won his biggest online tournament ever, which is great. I think he got about $7,000 for it. And then another one said that he was 18 out of 18 going into the final day of a $500 tournament at Parks. And he decided, you know what, I'm just going to go for it. I listened to a little coffee. Jonathan said, go for it. He went for it, and he chopped the tournament for about $75,000. So two nice scores for students over the last, 2 days. Greetings from the Lincoln Tunnel. Hello. Have you been in the Lincoln Tunnel before?
Yeah, I mean, get that measure.
Yeah.
My purple, and just slide off.
Yeah, whenever you drive with Paul Paul, that's right. So awesome. Congrats. Welcome to poker coaching. Study hard. Work hard. And you will succeed. So, in terms of preparation, first thing you have to know. You must know. This is my preparation. You have to know, what do you want? James, what do you want?
I want to a doctor.
You want to go to the doctor?
Yeah.
The other day, James saw Daddy and Mommy get flu shots, and he liked it. So now he has a little baby doll that his grandparents got him. He carries around saying, oh, we're going to the doctor to get a flu shot. So, that's fun. You have to know what you want. Come on. Relax. Can you look at the camera so they can see your face? Look, you gotta scoot back a little bit. Lean back a little bit so they can see your face.
No.
So, what do you want in life? What do you want in poker? What do you even want out of your day? A lot of people don't quite recognize. Do you want to sit up more? Let's see if I can sit more in this chair. See if I can sit somewhere. There we go. Now your face will be in.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't quite recognize that if you just start to have a plan for your day, you will get a whole lot more done than if you do not have a plan for your day. For example, I know that myself, lots of my friends, don't touch that. Myself and a lot of my friends will basically waste the whole day if given the opportunity. But if not given the opportunity, no, don't touch buttons. Don't touch anything while we're streaming, okay? Later. If you don't have a plan, you'll just squander your day. And I don't want you to squander your day. I want you to make good use of your day, right? And people always ask me, how am I so productive? It's because I have a very regimented day. I wake up early, take care of the boys. Then we do a little coffee, right? And I basically have two blocks of time. I have two big blocks of time where from 9 a.m. until... No, stop touching it. You can't touch it because you might turn it off. You might turn it off. And I don't want you to turn it off.
I will count these. One, two...
Oh, you're counting the keys?
Three,
yeah, don't touch it.
Four.
Yeah, don't touch
five,
it.
Five, six, seven, eight, 10.
What comes after 10?
Oh no! We missed that.
You missed it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. What comes after 10? Is it 11? 11? 12?
3. 10. Oh, that's it. Is that it?
Yeah, that's number 2 and number 12. That's right.
Right here.
What number is that?
I said 12. That's T for Thomas.
Oh, you see T for Thomas. That's right. James sees the keyboard here. We have the keyboard. James sees T for Thomas right here. That's right. There's T for Thomas. Can you find J for James? So anyway, I have 2 blocks of time from 9 a.m. until about noon, and then from about 1 until about 6. In that period of time, I work. I don't give myself downtime, because if I have downtime, I'll play Magic the Gathering or Hearthstone or do nothing. And you have to make sure
that that's so interesting.
That's so interesting? You muted it. Don't touch the microphone, okay? Oh, there's so many things you can't touch in here. Sorry, buddy. Job says you won the 500 buy-in live tournament yesterday. Congrats. Good job, good work. That's exactly what we were going for. So yes, you have to figure out how to structure your day so that you can make good use of your time, because you only have so much time in this world, right? No, this has to, look, if this, you have to put this down, otherwise it goes into the front of the camera, and you don't want it in front of the camera. James is really adorable. Enjoy watching them while they're young. Once you get old, you're not going to be adorable anymore. Yeah, that's true. That's very true. Very, very true. Enhancer Ed Brad, good morning. Hello, hope you're having a great day. Hope everyone's having a great day. It's bright and early. Surprise all of you are awake. It is what it is. I get it. You got to wake up and make it happen. Stop touching that, because if you touch that, it turns off the microphone. Okay. And you can't turn off the microphone, okay?
1 to 50. What's that?
If you don't...
Oh, there I go. No,
well, we'll see if it'll work again. Let's see if it'll work again. Yeah, let's see if it'll work again. I think you messed it up. 1 second, Instagram, sorry. If we're back, let me know. If anyone can type anything on Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, etc., that would be fantastic.
Daddy.
Don't poke through that. Are you just trying to break everything I have?
I'm trying to.
You're trying to? I can tell. I can tell. Alright, let's go live again. Alright. James turned off the computer somehow. Don't even know what he pressed. He didn't reset it. It was something very odd. Alright. Stop touching stuff, please.
Let me count it.
You can't count anymore. Sorry.
I'll count it, please.
Alright. Welcome back. We're back, I think. If we're here on YouTube, Twitter, etc., etc., let me know.
I'll count it.
And we'll continue moving forward. You have to prepare ahead. And the fail case here is that we send James away. It's always important to have a fail case, because quite often you will fail. Inevitably, things will go poorly, right? All right, I have to start talking to them about preparation, okay? So I'm going to let you go out there with Dalma. Can you say bye-bye?
Bye-bye.
Can you say have a great day? Can you say good luck in your games?
Good luck in your games.
Can you blow a kiss? Okay, bye. See you. You're a good boy. You're a good boy and always very curious. All right. Looks like my restreaming chat is somehow messed up. We'll load up a new one. Look at this fancy technology I have going on, huh? All right. Let's try to test this. Test, test. All right. There we go. Looks like the chat's working again. He is a cute kid. He is a cute kid. Someone berated me on YouTube for having James in videos. And you don't understand. This morning at like 8:50, he's banging on my door. Daddy, can I be in video? I'm like, sure, you can be in the video. You can, and then he comes in here and turns off my computer in midstream. Sorry, everyone. By the way, that's what happened. James turned off the computer midstream. But we're back. And I have sent him away. So today, we are talking about preparation. And it really does start by knowing what you want to accomplish. A lot of people don't actually have any goals or aspirations. And if you don't have goals or aspirations, you're just not going to get anywhere. It's basically impossible. And it's fine to not necessarily have goals and aspirations if you don't want to do anything. But I think most people out there want to achieve at least some level of greatness or competence at something. Humans want to succeed. And that implies that you are going to have to do some work. You just have to. So, like I said, that starts with planning your day. Figure out what you want. Let's say you do want to become a very good poker player. Let's just pretend like that's the case because this is a poker show. If you want to become a good poker player, don't just think, all right, I'm going to go and gamble and try to become a poker player. No, no, no. You need to have a regimen, right? And you need to plan your poker strategy. It takes time. It takes effort. And you will actually see that those who do work very hard very often get where they want to go. And those who slack off very often do not get where they want to go. I mean, I'm seeing this very, very clearly. Some of my friends were joking with me. They were asking, what is the average return on investment of people who are on my email list? The question is, are they break even? Are they small losers? Are they big winners? And I was thinking about it, and I'm pretty sure that the majority of people are like regular losing players because the majority of people don't actually want to do anything. But I said the people who are on poker coaching and actually working decently hard, I would bet that they are on average winners, small winners, but winners. And then the people who are really doing the study, who are spending time with me, I mean, I have this program I may be winding down at some point. It's called My Inner Circle. And we spend 4 hours together every 2 weeks discussing whatever questions they have, right? They ask me about specific topics and I present on them. They're usually much more technical than this, but kind of like this. And also, they call in live and they answer. I answer their questions. And one of those students who I told you won $7,000 yesterday, he is there every single time asking his questions. He also, same guy who cashed for like $20,000 a few weeks ago at Borgata. And this is like good money for someone who is just starting to grow their bankroll, who's really just kind of getting into poker. And that's fantastic, right? And the people who are actually spending time studying and working hard, those of my students are actually doing very, very well. Like 50% ROI or something, like a real legitimate professional ROI. I mean, many of the players in that group, they're playing 2-5 or 5-10 no limit all day, every day, making $50 to $100 an hour, just grinding it out. Who was the player who was staked? We staked three people so far at PokerCoaching.com. If you're a Poker Coaching member, by the way, you are very live to get staked. We've been buying people into $500, $1,000 tournaments, stuff like that. I know Louis-Philippe and Mitchell Kogert, who are often here. I know Louis-Philippe's here all the time. Mitchell's here every once in a while. Those are the players we staked for this month. They've not played yet, but they're there. Oh, there he is, Louis-Philippe. Hello. Louis-Philippe's a great example of someone who is in there working, right? He shows up, he does good work. I see him doing good work. And then, like, I'm happy to reward the people who do good work with, like, backing money and whatnot. Does poker coaching work on your phone? It works, it works on your phone. It works on mobile devices, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Whenever you are first getting started with anything at all, right, you need to recognize that the act of doing the thing, like playing poker, should not be your main priority if you actually care about winning and succeeding long term. You need to instead plan significantly. For example, if you're not good at poker and you decide, all right, I'm going to study for an hour a day and then play for 8 hours a day, then what's going to happen? Well, you'll get better, but you'll get better very, very slowly. As opposed to if you spend a lot of time studying and very little time playing. I mean, I am a beautiful example of this, where I knew I was bad at poker when I first started. I bought every poker book on the market. There weren't very many back then. and most of them weren't even that good, but I found a few that helped me get decent at limit hold'em. And I was better than the vast majority of players when I first started playing limit hold'em when I was 18 years old, because I had studied and they had not. And I spent $300 or so on educational poker stuff before I had ever even like played for any real money. And when I did buy in, it was only for a $50 buy-in. And that's because I was a person working a $10 an hour job. I had no significant income and no real savings or anything because I was 18 years old, right? And I did the best with what I had. I'm sure I could have expedited the process by hiring a private coach right off the bat, but that was not my situation, right? I didn't have any money. So I made the most of what I had. So I recognized back then the value in studying and preparation before actually doing the act, because to me, the last thing I want to do is take my money that I worked for and just straight up lose it. At least if I like buy a book and study the book, I learn a little something. If I go and gamble with it and lose, that's awful. And to be fair, my parents were very frugal whenever I was young. They didn't like giving away money, right? Well, I say giving away. They were fine with charity, but they didn't want to go and gamble it away. And that probably rubbed off on me as a kid. Now, I'm the opposite of that. I'll splash money around all day. I give money to you all the time, right? We give away, I think we're giving away like $3,000 a month or something now to people in raffles and backing and whatever, right? Because, hey, I don't mind. You all are providing me a great life, and I enjoy what I do, so I'm happy to give back. So, especially when you are getting started, you need to study a lot. I get this question a lot. How much time should I spend studying versus playing? And the answer is, are you good at poker already? Are you already winning? If you're already winning at a very high win rate, let's say in tournaments like 6 EV big blind per 100, then you probably don't need to be studying all that much. You instead need to be playing a lot. If you're winning at like 2 EV big blind per 100, that's a it's a way for online poker to kind of level out the variance you experience, because there's a lot of variance in tournaments. If you're winning at that rate, then you probably do need to be studying and you need to move down. And that is important. R. Gallo says, the problem is you study and learn a lot, but the place where you play, there's only one game and it's filled with very loose donkeys. Well, perfect. That's fantastic. That's exactly what you want. You want to be playing against very bad players. You have to understand that studying poker does not mean studying how to play one specific strategy or against one specific type of player. That's exactly what you want. Those players are terrible. And all you have to do is show up and play good cards and you'll win lots of money. Hopefully James is okay. James is fine. He's right outside. I hear him. I was fortunate to be able to start early, yeah, and be able to learn those habits when you were around your parents around the house. Yeah, it's definitely very true. Very, very true. I completely agree. Very, very fortunate to have solid foundations built as a young person. So anyway, you have to recognize that if your opponents are playing very poorly, that is great. And all you have to do is sit there and play and win all the money. I don't know what's going on with Facebook the last few days, but I'm not seeing any Facebook comments. You wonder why this is happening? Like over here on Facebook, look, there's just no comments. This happened a few days ago as well. If you're on Facebook, sorry, I can't see your comments. How do you prepare for a table who never 3-bets? Well, you get to play way more hands, right? It's fantastic. All you have to do is just raise much wider because you know you're not going to get 3-bet unless you're against the absolute nuts. Tom says you have to deal with variance and be flexible with your strategy when you're playing those very loose tables. Yeah, but also, when you say your strategy, your strategy should be to exploit whatever your opponents do incorrectly. So, if your opponents are too loose and too passive and they play any hand, put a lot of money in when you are clearly the favorite, and whenever they make it clear they have a good hand, stop paying them off. Easy, right? It's just a matter of understanding that is how you beat players who make that error. I prepare to fight fatigue later in a tournament. Get in shape before the tournament. Prepare ahead of time, right? Something I do is I try to not drink a whole lot of coffee before tournaments. I'll have like a cup a day. Here we are. But then I will, like during the tournament, I'll drink as much coffee as I want. And sometimes that'll mess me up a little bit. When I get back home, I'll be off my sleep schedule and my brain will be a little bit broken, but that's okay. I don't mind. That's seems like an easy sacrifice to make. And Also, you want to make sure you study a lot ahead of time, right? I think a lot of people, they get it in their brain that poker decisions all have to be strenuous. And if you don't mind variance and don't mind gambling and don't mind swings, then like you just don't care as much. Like some people, you'll see they're stressing out over everything, where you see other people like myself, I'm just sitting there chilling, right? Because I'm playing my card game and that's it, right? So it's not necessarily as mentally taxing for those who are very well prepared, right? So make a point to get prepared ahead of time. And that comes from studying, right? Also, try to get in good shape. It's enhance your edge mentions. Get in good shape, right? You need to make sure that you have stamina. Now, I don't think you need to have like gigantic muscles. I think gigantic muscles might actually be a bit of a detriment because those require lots and lots of calories. And, you know, it's fine to sit there eating food all day, but at the same time, you probably would rather not have to eat food all day. So I prefer to be more of like the lean muscle as opposed to like super, super gigantic muscle body. That said, you see some poker players like Scott Clements and Jason Kuhn, they're eating food all day and they're gigantic and it works for them, right? Do you ever get angry when I lose? No. Essentially never. I'll get angry if I make a bad play, but it's not anger, it's more of annoyance, right? That I would make a clear mistake. And quite often mistakes are not so clear, and you realize after the fact that you make mistakes sometimes. And I don't really beat myself up too much for those, because usually the mistakes are difficult to spot in-game, and you're going to make errors in-game, you just are. Especially whenever you're playing in tournaments with an action clock, where like a lot of WPTs now, deep in the tournaments, they have action clocks, so they give you 30 seconds. You have to accept that you're not going to be playing every decision perfectly, because you don't have all that much time to think it over. Update on the Paso lawsuit. Am I allowed to talk about it? I don't know. I am interviewing Mac Verstandig today. That should be up on YouTube later today with any luck. And I'm going to ask him various questions. If you all have questions for Mac, say question for Mac colon, and then type it in, and I will consider asking it. We're going to be discussing why he took on this case, differences between civil and criminal cases. We're going to go through the complaint and demand. And then really, we're just going to see whatever he can talk about, right? Because he may not be able to talk about, is there actually enough evidence? Can we actually collect on the $10 million they are seeking? What is the ideal outcome, you know? So I don't know if I'll be able to actually answer those questions, but I'm going to be doing that interview at 11 a.m. today with Mac. It's not going to be live. It's going to be recorded. And I'll put it up on YouTube later today. Have I seen the video of him playing PLO? Yeah, trying to get all of his cards through and it wouldn't do it. Oh my gosh. Like that clip right there is almost all you need. Can you bust stones to create accountability for the players? Well, so imagine you do collect $10 million off of stones. That very easily could just bankrupt them. But such is life. You're not allowed to have people promoting and I don't know. We're not going to get into that. Is it an advantage to have a poker player, Kelly Minkin, as one of the attorneys? Kelly Minkin is an associate at Verstandig Law Firm, if you did not know that. So it's not like this is her first case or anything. She has been an associate with Mac for at least a little while now. For those who don't know Mac, he's one of the best gaming lawyers in the country. He's gotten me out of a few binds where people have tried to screw me, and he gets the job done. So it's exciting. But no, the interview is not live, so don't think it's going to be live. Am I going to Jacksonville? Yes, I'm going to Jacksonville tomorrow. Tomorrow at bright and early in the morning, I'm flying to Jacksonville to play a $2,000 tournament. So there you go. What's a good ROI for low-stakes tournaments? Depends on the structure, depends on the rake, et cetera, et cetera. Depends on your skill level, right? What is a good ROI, though? For like a daily $100 tournament at a casino, probably 30% ROI because they take so much rake. Can you make a living off of 1-2 no limit? Well, if you can make about $20 an hour, is that a good living? It's up to you, right? You have to figure out if that's the case. All right, let's see. When do you see interstate poker gaming pool growing? I don't know about these kinds of things because I recognize that I am not in charge of the government. I can't make the government do anything, and I realize the government moves very, 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 very slowly. So, I don't know. You plan on line cash for quite some time now, and it seems that the low stakes are harder to beat than the mid stakes. I disagree with that. Players are better as they move up. You think the players at the lower stakes are less splashy? Maybe. I think everyone online just plays pretty well, and everyone who plays pretty well, you just can't have a big win rate off of them. But also, the rake is higher at the small stakes, which is why maybe you're having a tougher time winning. Do you do anything special in preparation for a poker series? No, essentially, not at this point. Basically, I am conditioned to be able to get up and go play poker all day, every day. And I have no problem doing that. So it's not like I have to get out of any sort of regular routine. Like, if you told me there was a soft poker game happening right now and I have to get up and leave and go play it, I could do that without a problem. It's not like I would be stressed out or nervous or not on my game, right? I slept last night. I had some vegetables for breakfast, so I'm good to go. How do you hide when you're nervous? Don't get nervous. Understand that you make plays because they are good. When you are bluffing, don't think, oh, I'm bluffing, I'm nervous. Think, this is what the play I'm supposed to be making. We are not having a meetup at Best Bet Jacksonville. There just isn't enough time. Also, it's Jacksonville is one of those places where you may end up just playing like really late and having to wake up really early, and I just can't deal with it this time. So sorry, but hey, if you see me, definitely come say hi. If there's a dinner break, come say hi, right? I'm happy to say hello. We're not going to do any sort of formal breakfast just because the timing is tough. Like, it's a little bit different when I go to, let's say, somewhere in Vegas. I can find days that I know are going to be not late days the day before and not early days the day of, and I can plan it better, right? I have many, many days to pick from. In Jacksonville, I'm only going to be there, I think, like 3 days at the minimum. Yeah, 3 days at the minimum if it just goes really poorly. And I can just be right out of there, no problem. Am I going to the Hard Rock in November? No, I'm going to the Bahamas for the Party Poker Caribbean Poker Party. That is a series I will literally never miss for the rest of my life. They add so much money to the prize pool. The games are so soft. The venue is so nice. And you can invest a ton of money in a short period of time. It's like exactly what I want. If I could go play that series all day, every day, I would. Let's see. Hope you have time to sign your book. Mario, I definitely have time to sign your book. Just come say hello. Find me anytime I'm not playing a hand, and I will come say hello. Just make sure I see you, clearly. Don't be afraid. Let's see. When you fly to Jacksonville to play a $2,000 tournament, isn't it like a $3,000 tournament because of the hotel and travel? Yes, hotel and travel are relevant. The way Jacksonville works is there's a $2,000 and then a $3,500. So only two tournaments. Flight is about $1,000. If you're a bounty, they give you a little bit of a kickback, so that helps with that. But yeah, normally I would not. Oh wait, is the main event $5,000? I think the main event's $5,000. I don't know. Doesn't really matter to me. The main event is, I think, $5,000 plus the $2,000 for the side event. I think that's right. And so let's call it $7,000, plus you get to re-enter if you feel like it, I think, one time? I don't know. Again, it just doesn't matter, right? So let's say you're going to be in for like $7,500 in the main event on average, plus $2,000. Let's call it $10,000 total buy-ins, plus $1,000 in expenses. So it's like $11,000 total buy-in. So the rake now is like, let's call it 20% out the door. So you have to have 20% ROI to break even. I think I do. Probably have more like 50%, maybe 70%. Because it's generally thought to be a pretty soft tournament. So, that's that. Where do they play the Caribbean series? That is at Baja Mar. It's a new resort in the Bahamas. It is amazing. It's very, very nice. Like I said, I'm just always going. Jom says, you remember when you used to be you used to be able to feel your face getting hot in a big decision. You could literally feel your temperature rising. Yeah, it's true. I mean, I remember this. I used to have this issue where my face would get all red whenever I was nervous. Still happens every once in a while. Never at poker. But it still happens every once in a while in like life. But weird because, like, I really don't feel so stressed in a lot of scenarios, but, like, I clearly must be because, like, I'll sweat a decent amount when I'm playing, and that's usually a sign of being stressed, but it's not like I feel stressed. So maybe my body and my brain, like, my subconscious brain actually are stressed, but, like, my higher-level brain just doesn't care. maybe that's it. Just, like, the higher-level brain just does not care. All right, what were we talking about? We were talking about preparation. Let's get back on that. Oh, I had to prepare for the Mac interview, so I have to go through and read the complaints. I'm going to have about an hour to do that before our interview. My face was getting red while James was smashing my computer earlier. Yeah. embarrassment is an interesting concept, right? Because you really have nothing to be embarrassed about in theory, right? I mean, yes, it matters what people think of you a little bit, but at the same time, it just, like, doesn't matter. Like, today, now I'm going to have two YouTube videos where one of them was just James doing nonsense and another one's a regular stream. And it's okay. You know, whatever. They can hit my YouTube account and make it get slightly less searches if they want. I don't care. There's a 20K tomorrow. Yeah, there's 20K in Jacksonville tomorrow. Yep. Anthony says, it helps with your nerves to convince yourself you have the hand that you are representing. And, yeah, sure. I mean, like, if you know you are bluffing, like, that's really it, right? Is when I'm in a scenario, I am bluffing because I think it is good, right? And if I think the bluff is good, why should I be nervous about this? I'm making a good play. You just have to figure that out, right? If you play the 20K, you'll be in my realm. I'm probably not playing the 20K. I don't even think it ran last year. And the year before that, I looked at the people who cashed, and they were all the best players in the world. So it's probably not going to be a very good tournament, especially compared to the 2K. What advice do I give to beginners? Sign up to PokerCoaching.com. Go to JonathanLittlePoker.com/free. Get your free copy of my ebook, Mastering Small Stakes and No Limit Hold'em. So sign up to PokerCoaching.com for a free trial. Go through all that content. Get Mastering Small Stakes, No Limit Hold'em, one of my books back there, for free on Audible. And that will cost you $0 and will give you, I don't know, 20 hours of stuff that you can study to drastically improve your skills quickly. From there, if you start making some money or if you just want to take your skills to the next level, sign up to Poker Coaching fully. Here's a good question from Enhance Your Edge. Let's see, is there a way for poker players create pressure on casinos to increase security? Will Possible be banned? Will Possible be banned from various series, et cetera, et cetera. Why'd I choose to go play best to Jacksonville instead of Mid-States Poker Tour? Jacksonville is a higher buy-in. Vin, essentially, if the buy-in is not, like, $5,000 main events, or they have some sort of good side events, I'm just not going to go. And that's just because it's not worth it to go in terms of return on investment. Read JonathanLittlePoker.com/travelrake for an explanation of that. Do I think DTO app is good? I do think it's good. It's a great way to help you learn GTO strategies, and you'll very quickly realize that no one knows GTO strategies. I was watching Dominic Niche, the creator of the app, play the DTO app, his app, on the stream the other day, and he was getting like half of the questions wrong, and I was making fun of him a bit, because they challenged me to come play. It was two guys, two good pros playing, and seeing how many out of 10 they could get right, and they were getting like, you know, 7 out of 10 right, which is about the rate that I get. It's probably about the rate that most good players get. And people who think they know and know how to implement GTO perfectly are fooling themselves, because it's very, very difficult. I mean, this is the whole purpose of PokerCoaching.com, is to make GTO strategies relatively easy to implement. And you're not going to be playing perfect GTO, but you're going to be playing way closer than the vast majority of people. And you're not really going to be guessing, because you'll have a relatively solid system in place to help you know how to play well. So you have to understand that in exchange for developing a system that is a strategy that is easy to implement, you give up some profitability, which is fine, because Everybody else is just guessing and clicking buttons. And when you see the best players in the world not being able to implement GTO, even in relatively simple scenarios like 20 or 40 big blind spots, that tells you that it is very, very hard to actually do. So develop a system that is actually implementable. And once you do that, then you're going to be way ahead of everyone else, especially if your system gets you pretty close to the right play, which is exactly what I teach at PokerCoaching.com. Mid-Stakes Poker 2 is $1,100 and it's a million guaranteed. So, Vin, one thing I think a lot of people really stress over or care about is the guarantee, but I think the guarantee is almost irrelevant. All the guarantee does is ensure that tournament will be soft. But what is a good ROI in a soft $1,000 tournament? 100%? So let's say you're going to have 100% ROI, but you have to spend $1,000 to get there. Basically, you're just going to break even, right? You have to spend $1,000 to go make $1,000 so you break even. I don't want to do that. I want to spend $1,000 to go invest $10,000 and be able to make 50% ROI, let's say. Half the ROI out the door, but minus expenses, now we're making $4,000 for a four-day trip. So $1,000 a day, as opposed to going somewhere where they're buying small and making $0, right? Chess says, you saw me playing with Mike Possel. Can you tell me about my experience with him? I honestly didn't even remember playing with him. I was there for Veronica and friends. I'm friendly with some of the players at the table. I didn't know Mike at all. And so I was more so having a lot of wine and talking with the people who I was friendly with. And I Mike was on the other side of the table for me. So I did not interact with him much at all. I think I lost one hand to him that he played fine. This was, I think, maybe even before he was cheating. But I have like literally no recollection. I only have recollection a little bit because I've seen the stream and I've seen myself sitting at the table throwing a party. But I get the fact that I was sitting there throwing the party, and when you're throwing a party and there's somebody else at the other end of the table not partaking in the party, then it's like you just don't remember that. So I honestly didn't remember it at all. And to be fair, my memory is awful. I can't remember that kind of thing unless something insane happens. And I actually do remember one hand we played where it was like, what was it? It was like raise, call, call. I think I 3-bet king 8 suited. Mike Possel cold called, folds back around to someone else who goes all in. So it was like 30, call, call, call. I made it 200 with king 8 suited. Mike Possel cold calls, big blind with jacks. Folds back around to someone who jammed it all in for like 600. I then jammed for like 1,000, and then Mike Possel called with the jacks. And I had the king 8 suited. I was against the other person who backjammed 9-8 offsuit. So he got me. So in theory, maybe I'm owed some money. I'll have to talk to Mac about that. What do I try to break down when going through hand histories? And basically, I'm trying to find spots where I screwed up. The nice thing about me making quizzes for my site, PokerCoaching.com, out of my real hands, is that I get to go back over them and see, I don't really like that play. And very often, I will find spots, especially on the turn in the river where things get much more difficult. I recognize that I screw up sometimes, right? And there are a few spots every once in a while where the best play is either clearly to, let's say, bet small or check. But I think checking is probably just better after I have 3 or 4 minutes to think it over, as opposed to being at the table and having 30 seconds to figure it out. And how do I know that? Because I have, again, we discussed these fundamentally sound systems. Obviously, you could run it through a solver, but solvers are only as good as the information you input, and very often you don't know the information about your opponent accurately. I mean, that's really the problem. So many people want to run solvers by inputting information that they are guessing about. So when you input trash, you get trash out, and that's a very big problem. You can input your opponent playing perfectly, but your opponent's not playing perfectly. Dominic Niche, one of the best players in the world, playing his own app that he made, can't get it all right, right? And this is like thought to be one of the best GTO players in the world, and he is. And I mean, I'm pretty good at it too, and I'm still not getting everything right. And recognizing that should help you realize immediately that just playing against a GTO opponent and you're using solvers is just probably not the right thing to do. So you can input different information, but then do you really think that you are smart enough to assume exactly or even close to exactly what your opponent is doing? And I'm not nearly egotistical enough for that, although some players are. Some people may also say that, well, you have to input something, right? So if you're going to input something, that's probably better than nothing. And that could be true, but you have to recognize that your calculations very easily could be far off. Which is fine if you recognize that, but a lot of people think that their calculations are definitively accurate, and that's just asinine. So many people don't get the idea that what you think is not actually what is accurate or what is reality. I mean, this Mike Possel thing is a good example, right? He's almost certainly cheating, and I say almost certainly because there's like a one in a million chance he's not, right? maybe it's... I mean, to be fair, I would probably take it at one in a million that he's not. I bet $1 to $1 million, yeah, sign me up. For sure. Probably 1 in 10,000, I think, is actually much closer. But a lot of people out there want to say things definitively. And especially with, like, poker education, so many people out there want to definitively say that a play is definitely right, or that they definitely know the right play, and you just don't. I mean, pile solver compared to Munker solver is a great example of this, right? If you look at the preflop ranges those two programs give you, they give you different preflop ranges. Why? Why do they give you different preflop ranges? Because one of the programs is actually better than the other program. Which one? It's tough to know, right? It's tough to know. Thought Munker's better, though, just so you all know. Takes forever to run the calculations, though, which things that take forever essentially cost you a lot of money to run them. All right. Do you find that the same play in the same spot will work on the same guy most of the time, but some nights he fights back? Basically, you're saying, should we do the same thing against the same people who make the same mistakes? Yeah, until they adjust, for the most part, unless you can predict when they're going to adjust. Is Poker Snowy GTO? Probably not. We're not even sure PioSolver's GTO. We don't know. Smart people realize we don't know. Ignorant people think they know everything. The more you know, the less you realize you actually know. The tuna's going to be jamming it all in for 60 big blinds. All right, come to my table. I'll give you a shot at the bounty. GTO is just a baseline. That is exactly right. It is a baseline, and you must accept that. All right. You're right, Louis-Philippe. What's Louis-Philippe saying? Did Louis-Philippe's comment get buried? Strategies of poker coaching are extremely solid, and the structure of premium is good as well. I'm glad you're enjoying it, Louis-Philippe. You might be my biggest fan. All right. Let's see. Am I playing any PLO cash games? Not really. Can I repeat what to do if you're beginning? Go to pokercoaching.com, here's the site, sign up for a free trial. Go to pokercoaching.com, sign up for a free trial. Go to jonathanlittlepoker.com, just my name in poker, /free, follow directions to get Mastering Small Stakes No Limit Hold'em. This book, right here. This book, you can get the audiobook for free. If you want to get PDF, you can buy it. Again, I'm trying to give you only free things. I'm not trying to tell you to spend money because I know you're just starting, right? If you're just starting, this type of book is going to be hard. It's not going to be the easiest read you've ever had, but it will make you significantly better at poker. Tom says that book is gold. Well, that was the goal, to make a golden book. Will my lawyer get access to all the footage from Stones? I mean, I think that's just very clearly publicly available. Oh, not just what is seen on the streams? I don't know. It's actually a good question. That's a good thing for me to ask him. Let me write this down. Actually, a very good question. Tom says you have three copies, audio, ebook, and physical. Well, that's fantastic. I actually do think physical poker books, by the way, are like way better than audiobooks in theory, because like, look, right? These charts, I can explain them, I can talk through them, but they're hard to actually fully accept or fully appreciate. And then also, you can like flip back and forth really easily. This is kind of difficult to do in an audiobook or even an ebook. That said, for the audiobook, You can go and download all the charts. I think it's dnbpoker.com/masteringcharts. There you go, if you forget it. I say it about 100 times in the book to make sure you all get them. So anyway, are free poker coaching members considered poker coaching members for the backing opportunities? We are definitely starting with poker coaching premium members and regular poker coaching members first. What do I think about the DTO app? Again, I think it's great. Recognizing you're playing against the perfect bot. Should you assume your opponents are perfect bots in the real world? No, you shouldn't. Which is why you have to learn to adjust, which is a whole lot of what I teach at PokerCoaching.com. Does GTO mean you only play polarized range? No, absolutely not. Seems like linear ranges are more exploitative. It depends. So, Alan, I discussed this in depth at JonathanLittlePoker.com/cash. I have an in-depth cash game course, which definitely applies to deep stack tournaments as well. But essentially, you have a range advantage and nut advantage. And those two things very, very heavily influence whether or not you're betting or checking and how much you bet or check. Oh, speaking of which, if you got that course, or if you're a Poker Coaching Premium member, we're having a free webinar for you today. What time is that webinar? I think it's at 8 p.m. tonight on when you should lead, especially on the turn and the river. I believe that's the scenarios we're discussing. Primarily the turn. I think it's what we're discussing is when you should lead the turn. Let me just look at my PowerPoint real quick. I made this like a month ago. Yeah, when to lead the turn after check calling the flop. We have a completely free webinar as part of the course. We're trying to always add new content to PokerCoaching.com that you all suggest. You all wanted to know specifically when to lead the turn, so I'm doing a presentation on that tonight for everyone who was part of that. Also, at 2 p.m. today, I have another webinar. I forget exactly what it's on, though. Goodness gracious. I have so much going on today. So, get this. A little coffee at 9 a.m. At 11 a.m., Magnus Standig interview. At 2 o'clock, a presentation on, I believe it's 5 key tips to significantly improve your skills. And then 8 p.m., when to lead the turn webinar. Call it 6 hours of me making content today. We discussed being prepared, all right? That's pretty prepared. Well, maybe not necessarily prepared. It's pretty busy. But I will be relatively prepared, so it'll be fine. Do I run a stable? I'm a part owner of the Pokar Backing Stable, pokarr.com. To be fair, I don't actually run it or anything. I'm more of a consultant. That's the word. How do you find leaks? Take notes on your hands. Go to JonathanLittlePoker.com/notes. Take notes. Study your hands. Go through them. As we discuss at PokerCoaching.com, right? I have the homework challenges. And the homework challenges explain how to go through hands. So go through all of your hands and figure it out. If you can't make the webinars live, will they be able to be watched later? Well, if you're not a Poker Coaching Premium member, or if you did not buy the Cash Masterclass, no, you can't see the When to Lead the Turn webinar, because that is for those people. The webinar on 5 tips, that is for everyone, and that will be posted on YouTube. Can you apply a no limit hold'em strategy to spread limit game or pot limit game? To some extent. They're different games, right? If you want access to any of these and you did not get the emails, you should have gotten emails already. If you didn't get the emails because you're not on my email list, you screwed up. But if you send me an email at support@pokercoaching.com, we will get you the links. If you had kids, I do have kids. They were here one of them was here this morning. Would you be okay with them pursuing poker for a living? Sure. I would probably recommend other things. The problem with poker, big problem with poker, is that the amount of money you can potentially win is essentially capped at something like 200K a year. Obviously, there are some outliers, but you have to presume you're not going to be an outlier. So 200K a year, I think, is about what most very highly motivated people can make if they are willing to structure their life around it. So 200K a year is a lot of money. I get, like, that's plenty, right? Back in the day, I think the potential was higher, but I think that number may continue to decrease as time moves forward. Maybe not. But games get harder as time moves forward. They all do. So, if that's the case, then you need to presume you'll be making less. My first poker coach, Bill Seymour, a long time ago said, always assume your win rate's about half of what it is, and then only spend about half of that. Like, plan to spend about half of that. So if you're making $100 an hour, live like you're making $25 an hour. And that'll keep you from being broke, ever. And it turns out it's true. It's $200K a year. Does that mean online? Does that mean live? What does that mean? That means, let's get out the calculator real quick. Let's say you can make $100 an hour playing 5, 10, no limit. And we're going to play 8 hours a day. That's $800 a day. Okay? Times 5 days a week. Times 52 weeks a year. That's $208,000. A $100 an hour job is $208,000 a year. If you play 40 hours a week. I, back in the day, played about 60 hours a week. Multiply that number by 1.5, you come up with, what, 300-something thousand a year. 312,000 a year. So, that's it. And again, I said you have to be able to reasonably structure your life around your goal of making a lot of money. But I think that that's like a reasonable goal and something that is reasonably obtainable for most people. If they really, really devote their life to it. Most people don't want to devote their life to it, though. They want to, well, not devote their life to it, which is fine, right? So, let's assume you can even make $20 an hour. You divide this number by 5. Now you're making $41,000 a year. If you, you know, just want to be a solid winning 1-2 player or 1-3 player, make $41K a year. It's fine. But do I want my kid to pursue something where the cap, effective cap, is $200K? And I think I would say no. And the reason for that is because there are many other things, just like business, where the cap is much, much higher, if there even is a cap, right? I mean, obviously there are some things, like the poker coaching industry, I'm somewhat capped because there are only so many poker players who care about getting good, or so many poker players, period. But I would definitely tell my kids to pursue something that can be scalable, better scalable. And sitting at the table playing poker is not very scalable. And even then, like, I'm trying to do it by owning a piece of a backing company, right? And because I'm having people play poker. There are literally 100 people somewhere in the world playing poker right now, and I get some of their action. And those are like, you know, little dollars added to my pocket every time that happens. But even that can only scale so much because it's hard to find good people, right? So it's a difficult thing. I don't think poker, actually playing poker, is all that scalable, and I would teach my kids to do scalable things. I think that's how you really get very, very wealthy, and it's also how you impact a lot of people. I think a lot of people don't realize that whatever you do, you probably don't need to get into it for the money. You need to get into it because you enjoy it and it makes you feel good, and it helps others. You're going to find that helping others is way better than helping specifically yourself. And this is why I like my poker coaching industry. Because I help you all enjoy your hobby or potential career more, right? So, I did not get into the poker educational space to make money, but the side effect of helping lots and lots and lots of people is that inevitably you can make money, right? And that's the case with anything. If you make something that people enjoy, if you help people enjoy their lives more, and you turn on the monetization spigot even a little bit, you will make money. As simple as that, right? Because people want, like, for poker coaching, I mean, I'm a case study for this. People want to learn about poker, and they want to improve their skills. Some do, not all, but some do. And that's great. And I'm here for them. Is a donk bet ever viable? Sure. We're going to talk about that tonight. Tonight or is it 2 o'clock? I'm getting my times confused. I'm not very prepared. So much going on. I'm a legend. I'm not a legend, I'm still alive. Or do legends have to be dead? I don't think they have to be dead. There's a living legend. You have a question about backing. If you don't have any results based on playing tournaments, how do you go about showing you're worth staking? Oh, Damien, you're probably not worth staking. Hate to break it to you. At Pokar, we only back people who have already proven decent results. At even the small stakes games, right? So, you need to go back and figure out, how do I get results? Well, you get in there and you play and you make it happen. And if you can't get in there and play and make it happen, then you should not expect to be backed. And also, we turned down a whole lot of winners. Because, why? We don't think they're motivated enough. They may not put in enough volume. They don't want to devote their life to it. Right? So fine. They're not for us. It's okay. It's okay for them to not be for us. But yeah, if you, as Doctor here says, play 1,000 multi-table sit-and-goes at 25-cent level and see how you do. That's exactly right. Play small stakes, grind it up, show, look, I don't have a lot of money, but I put $50 on the site, and I turned $50 into $500. I have been studying hard and working hard for the last 6 months. Here is my win rate. And if you prove that to people, they'll at least consider it, right? And the nice thing about that is that if you turn 50 into 500, you can turn 500 into 5,000 and 5,000 into 50,000. That's the great thing about poker is that you very quickly get rewarded based on your dedication and your work. You final table a bunch on Global Poker. How do you show that? I don't know, man. Does Poker Tracker work? What online site do I recommend? Party Poker and Poker Stars are the two big sites that I am happy trusting my money on. I have only money on Party Poker and Poker Stars. I have no money on any other poker site. So there you go. How should you play against looser players? Just play better hands and value bet more often. Right? And then fold whenever they make it clear they have the nuts. All right, I have to go. I think online poker in Pennsylvania is something to get excited about. I don't get excited about most things. I'm pretty level-headed. I am definitely not going to travel to Pennsylvania to play online poker. So, like, I don't travel to New Jersey right across the bridge or the tunnel or however you get there to play online poker. So if I'm not going there, I'm definitely not going to go to Philadelphia or Pennsylvania. That said, sure. I hope all of these states get their act together. I hope they all legalize poker. I'm all for the legalization of online poker. I'm all for regulation of it. I am not for heavy taxation of it because then nobody's going to win. But, yeah. Especially if you live in a place where they're making it legal, try to work hard because it's like clearly on the cusp of being made legal and you want to make it happen. On Ustake, you've seen some players with little or no results. Some of them even charge markup and get backed. Yeah, well, they usually the people buying on those sites are not so in the know. Because if you have to post on Ustake, and if you have to post on those sites, it kind of implies you don't actually have a good network of people who trust your results. Like, I'm a good example of that, right? If I want to sell action for a $25,000 buy-in tournament, which I will, there's one in Party Poker, or at Party Poker in November coming up, I'm going to sell some action. It's already sold, actually, because I have a few people I say, hey, you want this action? And they realize it's a value, and they scoop it up every time. It takes one text, and it's sold. What about a poker coaching tournament? We have a tournament. If you go to jonathanlittlepoker.com/homegame, that's not exactly a poker coaching tournament, though. Shannon, we're considering it. We're kicking the idea around. It's a lot of work. There's so much work that goes involved into so many things, and I currently have my hands full with all sorts of stuff, so maybe it'll happen one day, maybe not. I have to go. Instagram says I have 15 seconds. Have a great day. Enjoy yourselves. Good luck in your games. Have fun. And I'll talk to you next time.